Hello all. Now today we will be discussing about protozoan disease. Like we will be discussing about the treatment of malaria and the drugs for malaria. Malaria is caused by a protozoa known as Plasmodia. Okay, or a singular form Plasmodium. Then we will discuss about amoebiasis. Amoebiasis is caused by a protozoa Entamoeba, Histolytica. Okay. Then we will discuss about trypanosomas. Then we will discuss about the infection caused by a protozoa known as Leishmania. And after that, we will discuss about all the remaining or miscellaneous protozoan infection. Okay, so all the protozoan infection we will discuss today. So let's start with the first one, that is malaria caused by a protozoa Plasmodium. Okay, so let's make a heading, malaria. Okay, now malaria, it is caused by a species of protozoa we know, that is Plasmodium. And this Plasmodium, remember, it has five species which causes infection in human, that is Plasmodium falciparum, Plasmodium vivax, ovale, malaria, and lastly a new species, Nolesi. Okay, so these five species, they cause infection in humans. Now how this malaria spread? The transmission of malaria is due to a bite of a mosquito. That mosquito name is female anopheline mosquito. Okay, so only female species it causes malaria, not male species. Okay, because female needs blood for the maturation of young ones. And the guidelines for the treatment of malaria is given by WHO, and in India it is given under a program known as National Vector Borne Disease Control Program. Okay, National Vector Borne Disease Control Program. So first we will write the names of the drugs which are used for malaria. Drugs for malaria. Okay, so let's write a mnemonic for the drugs for malaria. We'll write a mnemonic, Machchar. Okay, M for Mefloquine, Etobicoke. Okay, chloroquine. And chloroquine is a group which we will discuss. It contains various other drugs which will end with the word queen, like you will write primaquine, tafenaquine, piperaquine, and lastly amodiaquine. Okay, so they are all are ending with the word queen. Then you will write a drug, halofrentine, halofentrine, and a congener of halofrentrine, that is lumefantrine. Okay, then we have a group known as artemisinin group. Again, artemisinin will have many drugs. They will start with the word RT, we will discuss. And lastly, racemic mixture of quinine. Okay, so these are the drugs. Apart from this, there are other drugs also. You can write a mnemonic for that also. So this is the mnemonic, Machchar. Okay, then you can write a mnemonic, Plasmodia can die slowly. So generally these drugs are slow acting drug. From P you will write proguanil, pyrimethamine. We will discuss they are folic acid inhibitor, pyrimethamine. Okay, one more drug you will write, a very important drug but not used in India, it is used in other countries like China, that is pyroneridine. Okay, C for you will write clindamycin, D for doxycycline, which is a tetracycline group of antibiotic, and lastly you will write sulfonamides like sulfadoxine, sulfamethoxypyrazine, and one sulfonamide which is used in leprosy but not used in malaria, but it has been found to be effective in malaria, that is Dapsone. Okay, Dapsone. So it is also a sulfonamide. So this is the complete list of our drugs which are used in various in the whole world. Okay, but apart from this there are certain drugs which are under trial, which are right now not approved but they are under trials. So if you will write their names, you can write the mnemonic ASIF. A for you will write artiphenomel. It is a new artemisinin, but right now it is under clinical trial. It is among artemisinin group, but right now it is under clinical trial. Then you will write sevoparin. It's still under clinical trial. Remember, sevoparin, it inhibit myrosoid adhesion or invasion. So it has been tried in malaria and the results are promising. It's also been tried in sickle cell disease. Okay, so right now it is not approved. Then you will write isoquine. It's a new drug just like chloroquine, but right now it is not approved. And lastly you will write fosmodomycin. Okay, now this fosfendomycin, it inhibit you will write epicoplast, DOXP, isoprenoid enzyme. This enzyme is needed for synthesis of sterol. Okay, steroid synthesis. So right now these drugs are not approved, just for your reference you will write. Okay, so let's see the treatment of malaria. Okay, let's see the treatment of malaria. Okay, for the treatment of malaria we must know the life cycle of malaria. Okay, so let's see first what is the life cycle, and according to the life cycle we have the drugs. Okay, so let's see, suppose there is a mosquito known as female anopheline mosquito. Suppose this is a mosquito. When this mosquito bites a human, the infective stage of Plasmodia which affect human is known as sporozoites. Now this sporozoite, remember, do not produce any symptom in the malaria. These sporozoites, they go to the liver. And inside the liver cell, these sporozoites, they divide. Now remember, any stage of Plasmodia which is inside a cell is known as schizont. Okay, it is known as shy jaunt. Any stage which is inside the cell is known as shy jaunt, and the stage which is outside the cell is known as merozoites. Okay, now first of all, these sporozoites, which are infective stage to human, they infect, remember, they enter into liver cell. This stage is known as hepatic schizogony. Okay, this first stage is known as hepatic schizogony. Then when they will divide in sufficient number, remember, these sporozoites, they come into the blood, they are released into the blood. When they come into the blood, they are known as merozoites. Okay, now the point is, in cases of P. falciparum, all or 100% of all of these plasmodia, they suddenly come into the blood. It also occurs in cases of malaria and nolesi. Okay, all the sporozoid, they will suddenly come into the blood. But what happens in cases of other species? In species of, you will write, vivax and ovale, in cases of vivax and ovale, some of the sporozoids, they will go under, they will undergo into sleep. In cases of vivax and ovale, they undergo into sleep. Let's say 50% will come into the blood, 50% will remain there. Okay, in vivax and ovale, 100% will not come into the blood. Some of them, they will go into sleep. This stage, sleeping stage, is known as hypnozoites. Hypnosis means sleeping. Okay, this is known as hypnozoitic stage. So hypnozoitic stage is seen in cases of only and only vivax and ovale. It is not seen in cases of P. falciparum, which causes most of the infection in India. Okay, now, till now, there will be no symptom. These merozoites, they will enter into RBC. This is known as erythrocytic schizogony. Erythrocytic schizogony. Till now, there will be no symptom. Now, when this sporozoid, they will rupture the RBC and they will come into the blood again, now the symptoms will come. So the symptoms of malaria will come after rupture of RBC, and after that they will again infect other RBC, and this cycle will keep on repeating. That is why malaria, it produces periodic symptoms. Periodic means after every third and fourth day the symptoms of malaria comes, like headache, fever, malaise, body ache, etc. Okay, erythrocytic schizogony. So the symptoms come when the RBC gets ruptured. So this is the third stage. Okay, so can we say that erythrocytic schizogony is the main stage when the symptoms of malaria will come? So that is why this hepatic schizogony, it is also known as, which is occurring before erythrocytic schizogony, it is known as pre-erythrocytic schizogony, and hypnozoite is also known as exo, that means it is outside this now normal cycle, exoerythrocytic schizogony. Okay, so hepatic schizogony is also known as pre-erythrocytic schizogony. Here the symptom will not come. Hypnozoite stage is known as exoerythrocytic schizogony. Okay, now what will happen, some of these merozoites, instead of infecting RBC, they will be converted into gametes. They will be converted into gametes, both male and female gametes. Male and female gametes. But remember, fertilization or fusion of male and female gamete will not occur in human. Okay, these gametes, they are uptaken by the bite of mosquito. These gametes, they are uptaken by the bite of mosquito, and fertilization of gamete occurs inside the mosquito. Okay, and after these gametes they get fertilized, they will go to the salivary gland and they will be converted into sporozoids. Okay, so that is why this mosquito female anopheline where fertilization takes place is known as definitive host, because in definitive host fertilization takes place, while man or human it is intermediate host of malaria. Man or human is an intermediate host of malaria. Okay, so understood this point. Now what is the importance of gamete? Remember, gamete will not produce any symptom, but gamete are responsible for transmission of malaria. Gamete is responsible for transmission of malaria to other individual. Okay, so this is the complete stage of malaria cycle. Now let's see, what do we mean by the treatment of malaria? When you talk about the treatment of malaria, remember there are two words which you must remember first. One is known as cure of malaria and second is known as prophylaxis of malaria. Okay, one is known as cure of malaria, one is known as prophylaxis. Now this cure is also divided into two. One is known as clinical cure and second is known as radical cure. Okay, one is known as clinical cure, second is known as radical cure. Similarly, prophylaxis is also divided into two. One is known as causal prophylaxis and second is known as suppressive prophylaxis. Suppressive prophylaxis. This suppressive prophylaxis is also known as traveler's prophylaxis. So it is given in the travelers. Okay. Now let's see, what do we mean by this cure? Now before writing this cure and prophylaxis, you must remember one point. There is no single agent or single drug which can kill all stages of malaria. Okay, there is no single drug which can kill all stages of malaria. Okay, hence we need a combination of a drug. That is why we need a combination of a drug for the treatment of malaria. There is no single agent which can kill all the stages, hence we need combination. Now let's see, what do we mean by this cure? Let's talk about this cure first. Now clinical cure means, suppose this is the blood of a patient, and in blood we know that sporozoids, they are present inside the RBC and merozoids, they are present outside the RBC. Clinical cure means that we must kill both inside the RBC and outside the RBC plasmodia. Kill all species, all types of plasmodia which is present inside the RBC and outside the RBC. Okay, this is known as clinical cure. Now what do we mean by radical cure? Radical cure means to kill hypnozoids. Radical cure means to kill hypnozoids. Understood this point? Radical cure means to kill hypnozoids. Now remember one point, that in cases of Plasmodia falciparum, which causes the most severe and most common infection in India, we need to give clinical cure. Okay, we need to give clinical cure, but there is no need of giving radical cure. Okay, there is no need of giving radical cure, because P. falciparum malaria, there is no hypnozoid stage or a dormant stage. Okay, but what about Vivex and Ovale? What about Vivex and Ovale? In Vivex and Ovale, we have to give both clinical cure as well as radical cure. Okay, we have to give clinical cure as well as radical cure, because Vivex and Ovale, they have hypnozoitic stage as well. Okay, now what is the drug we have? Remember, unfortunately for radical cure of a malaria, there is very few option. The drug of choice for radical cure of malaria is primaquine. ओके. द ड्रग ऑफ चॉइस फॉर रेडिकल क्योर ऑफ मलेरिया इज प्राइमाक्विन एंड राइट नाउ वी हैव अ न्यू ड्रग रिसेंटली बीन अप्रूव दैट इज टेफिनाक्विन. दैट इज टेफिनाक्विन. इट हैज बीन रिसेंटली अप्रूव्ड. बट रिमेंबर दिस प्राइमाक्विन इज नॉट इफेक्टिव इन दिस केस. Not effective in this case. Now, what are the drugs we have for clinical cure? You will write all drugs are given for clinical cure of malaria except primaquine. Primaquine is not effective. Okay? Primaquine is not effective. All drugs like you will write chloroquine, artemisinin. You'll write ACT. ACT will be artemisinin based combination therapy, quinine, etc. All drugs are there except primaquine. Primaquine is not effective in this case. Okay. Now there is a point out here. The point is, sir, if you will not give radical cure in cases of Vivex and Ovale, if you will not give radical cure in case of Vivex and Ovale, it will lead to relapse of malaria. Okay? If we will not give radical cure in cases of Vivex and Ovale, it will lead to relapse of malaria. And if we will do incomplete killing in cases of clinical cure, it will lead to recrudescence of malaria. Okay? It will lead to recrudescence of malaria. So, what do we mean by recrudescence? Incomplete clinical cure. What do we mean by relapse of malaria? When we are not giving our incomplete radical cure. Okay. So, can we say that recrudescence, relapse is seen with only Vivex and Ovale, while recrudescence is seen with all species of malaria. Okay. Relapse is seen only with Vivex and Ovale. And recrudescence is seen with all species of malaria. Okay? All species of malaria. So try to remember. Now let's talk about prophylaxis. There are two types of prophylaxis. One is causal prophylaxis. Second is suppressive or traveler's prophylaxis. Okay. Now, what do we mean by causal prophylaxis? Causal prophylaxis means to kill hepatic schizogony. Is to kill hepatic or pre-erythrocytic schizogony. Okay? To kill hepatic or pre-erythrocytic schizogony. That is known as causal prophylaxis. But we have learned that at this stage, the patient is asymptomatic. When the patient is at causal prophylaxis, the patient is asymptomatic, the patient will not come to you. So theoretically it can be given, but practically it is not possible. It is practically not possible to give causal prophylaxis to a patient of malaria, because the patient at this stage is asymptomatic, hence it is practically impossible to give. But what are the drugs which can kill this schizogony, which is present inside the cell? You will write PPAD. Okay. The most effective drug is again primaquine. Most effective. Then you will write proguanil. Proguanil is combined with a drug known as atovaquon. And this combination is given in America but not in India. Okay. And lastly, doxycycline. Okay. So these are the drugs which are effective against it they which are given for causal prophylaxis, because it is the cause of symptoms of malaria. Because if this hepatic schizonts will come into the blood, it will produce symptoms of malaria. That is why it is known as causal prophylaxis. It will prevent the cause of malaria. Now, what do we mean by suppressive prophylaxis? Suppose this is the blood of a patient and this is RBC. This is RBC. Now, suppressive prophylaxis means we have to prevent this merozoites to enter into RBC and kill this schizonts which are present inside the RBC only. Which are present inside the RBC only. Because if they will rupture the RBC and come outside, it will produce symptoms. If this schizonts will come out of the RBC, they will produce symptoms. And if we will kill them in between, the symptoms will be suppressed and the symptoms will not come. Okay? So this is known as suppressive prophylaxis. Now for suppressive prophylaxis, remember three drugs are approved. The first drug is chloroquine. Okay? First drug is chloroquine. Second drug you will write is mefloquine. And the third drug you will write for traveler's prophylaxis is doxycycline. Okay, third drug is doxycycline. Now the point is, chloroquine is the drug of choice if a patient is going to a country where there is no chloroquine resistance. Okay, so if there is chloroquine sensitivity, only then they give this chloroquine. Okay, while these two drugs are given to a traveler who is going to a country where there is chloroquine resistance. Okay, if the patient is going to a country where there is high chloroquine resistance, then we give mefloquine. Example of these countries you can write, like if the patient is going to Gulf countries, there is no chloroquine resistance out there. Okay, but if the patient is going into Africa, Asian countries, and you will write Southeast Asia region like India, China, Bangladesh, Nepal, Asian countries are Vietnam, Cambodia, Bangkok, Thailand, etc. Then we give mefloquine. Now how to give? So this chloroquine is given 600 milligram once a week. It should be started 2 weeks before, 2 weeks before going to a particular country, and it should be continued for 4 weeks after coming back to own country. So if a patient is going to a specific country, before catching a flight or going to that country, the patient should start taking chloroquine 2 weeks before, and it should be taken once a week. The patient will eat chloroquine once a week during his or her stay, and the patient when come back to its home country will take chloroquine for another 4 weeks. Okay, and same is the regimen for mefloquine, but the dose of mefloquine is 250 milligram once a week. Okay, and it should be given just like chloroquine. It should be started 2 weeks before, and it should be continued for another 4 weeks by coming back to the country. And what about doxycycline? The dose of doxycycline is 100 milligram daily. Okay, and it should be start 2 days before. And it should be continued for 4 weeks by coming back to the home country. Okay. So can we say that this mefloquine is more convenient to take because it is given once a week? Agreed? Once a week. That is why if a patient is going on a long holiday, like if a patient is going for a holiday for more than 6 weeks, then a patient should take mefloquine. But if the patient is going for a shorter holiday, shorter travel, less than 6 weeks, the patient should take doxycycline. So mefloquine is given for those prophylaxis in which a patient is going for more than 6 weeks and doxycycline for less than 6 weeks. Now the point is, this doxycycline, remember, it is absolutely contraindicated in children less than 8 weeks, and it is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. So doxycycline should not be given. Now the point is, if a patient is of children less than 8 weeks or pregnancy, remember, the main treatment for prophylaxis is personal protection. Personal protection. What about mefloquine? Remember, mefloquine can be given in children. Can be given in children. But this mefloquine should not be given in pregnancy. It should not be given in pregnancy for prophylaxis. Okay? But main treatment of children and pregnancy, pregnant females going to a country, is personal protection. It is not the drug mefloquine. Okay? So this is the treatment of suppressive prophylaxis or traveler's prophylaxis. Now the next point is gametocidal agent. Now why we need to give a gametocidal agent? Gametocidal agent is given to prevent transmission or spread of malaria. Or spread of malaria. Okay? Now, the best gametocidal agent we have, the drug of choice is again primaquine. Okay, that is primaquine. That is the most effective drug. But what are the other drugs? Other drugs are partially effective. These partially effective drug against gametocidal agents are, you'll write C, A, and Q. That is chloroquine, artemisinins, and quinine. Hence, the drug of choice as a gametocidal agent is again primaquine. Apart from these four drugs, no other drug is effective against gametocidal agent. And lastly, we have the drug which can kill sporozoid. Remember, there is no drug we have which can kill sporozoid. Hence, remember, we cannot prevent transmission of malaria. If a mosquito will bite, the sporozoid will cause infection in human. Okay, so to kill sporozoid, we don't have any drug. Okay, here there is a potential role of a vaccine. Here there is a potential role of a vaccine. So right now there is no approved malaria vaccine, but there are vaccines which are under clinical trial. One vaccine is Mosquirix. Okay, but right now it is not approved on a large scale, so it is not given under our program. Okay, so keeping this thing in mind, these are the various drugs. Let's see the drugs for treatment of malaria. Or cure of malaria. How do we give cure of malaria? Okay, in there are various regimens which are approved by WHO, and in India we give the treatment of malaria under a program known as National Vector Borne Disease Control Program. Okay, now according to National Vector Borne Disease Control Program, let's see what is the treatment of malaria. So first we will write the treatment of Vivex and Ovail. Vivex and Ovail. Now the treatment of Vivex and Ovail is chloroquine with primaquine. Okay. The treatment of Vivex and Ovail is chloroquine and primaquine. Now chloroquine is given for 3 days. That is 10 plus 10 plus 5, okay, milligram per kg. And primaquine is given for 14 days. at a dose of 0.25 milligram per kg. Okay, 0.25 milligram per kg. Now, why we are giving chloroquine? Why we are giving two drug? What is the rationale? Chloroquine is given for clinical cure, to kill blood stages, erythrocytic stages, and primaquine is given for radical cure, to kill hypnozoites. Okay, primaquine is given for hypnozoites. Now, what is the treatment of falciparum? The treatment of falciparum, you will write, there is in India, there is widespread chloroquine resistance. Hence, chloroquine is not given for the treatment of falciparum malaria in India. Okay. So, in cases of P. falciparum, what is the treatment? The treatment will depend upon the states of India. You write all states of India. Northeastern states of India. Okay. Now, you'll write in all states of India, the treatment is, you'll write ACT, that is artemisinin based combination therapy. Okay. So, the treatment of P. falciparum malaria is ACT, that is artemisinin based combination therapy. So, we will combine one artemisinin with another drug. So, in all states of India, the treatment is artesunate, which is a type of artemisinin, with sulfadoxine, pyrimethamine combination. Okay, sulfadoxine pyrimethamine combination. Okay, but what about northeastern state? Remember, in northeastern state there is a resistance to sulfadoxine pyrimethamine. Hence, in northeastern state we give artem either with lumefantrine. Okay, lumefantrine. So, in all states of India, the treatment is artesunate sulfadoxine pyrimethamine combination. In northeastern state, we will give artem either, M word is coming with lumefantrine. Here, S word is coming. Okay? Because there is resistance to sulfadoxine and pyrimethamine reported in northeastern states of India. And you will combine one drug. These drugs, you will give primaquine. Okay? Primaquine. Here also you will add primaquine. Now these drugs are given for 3 days. Again, these drugs are given for 3 days. What about primaquine? Primaquine is given as a single dose on second day. Both cases. Primaquine is given as a single dose on second day. Now, what is the rationale of giving these drugs? This ACT, that is, these drugs, artesunate sulfadoxine and artemether lumefantrine, they are given for clinical cure of malaria. And why primaquine is given? Primaquine here is not given for radical cure, because there is no hypnozoid stage in falciparum. Primaquine here is given as a gametocidal agent. In cases of P. falciparum, primaquine is given as a gametocidal agent, not for a radical cure. Okay? Not for a radical cure. So, for the treatment of P. falciparum malaria, the treatment is ACT along with primaquine. So, the summary is ACT with prima queen on second day. And which artemisinin based combination therapy we use, we know that. In all states of India, artesunate sulfadoxime pyrimethamine, in northeastern state, lumefantrine. Okay, but the point is, if there is mixed infection, that means if there is mixed infection of falciparum with Vivex and Ovale, now the treatment will become ACT, same ACT, that is artesunate sulfadoxime pyrimethamine and lumefantrine, but change this primaquine into 14 days. ACT with primaquine for, not as a single dose for second day, primaquine here we will give for 14 days. Okay, and ACT for 3 days. Because here primaquine will be given both as a radical cure, because we need radical cure in cases of Vivex and Ovale, and for gametocidal agent. Okay, gametocidal in both cases. Okay, this is the treatment of mixed infection. So this is the approved ACT regimen. Now what are the other approved regimen? Other approved regimens, you'll write, the other approved regimens are, you'll write artesunate. It can be combined with other drugs like either M or with A or with P. Okay, so it can be combined with mefloquine. It can be combined with amodiaquine. It can be combined with pyroneridine. Okay, so this is the other approved regimens. Fourth, you will write dihydro artemisinin. Fifth, you will write artirolane. It can be combined with piperaquine. And same, artirolane is also combined with piperaquine. Okay, piperaquine. And the last option we have, which is nowadays less preferred, is quinine along with doxycycline. Okay, these are the other approved regimen for the treatment of malaria. Okay, that is chloroquine resistant malaria in cases of P. falciparum. Okay, chloroquine resistant falciparum malaria. Now the point is, this doxycycline is contraindicated in children less than 8 years and in pregnancy. If a female or a child will come to you, replace this doxycycline with clindamycin. Replace this doxycycline with clindamycin, because clindamycin is safe in children and safe in pregnant females. Okay, it is safe in children and safe in pregnant females. So these are the other treatment regimen. Now the third type of malaria we will write is complicated malaria. Okay, third type of malaria we will write is complicated malaria. Now what is the definition of complicated malaria? Complicated malaria is that malaria that requires parenteral therapy. That requires parenteral therapy, that means injections. Okay, so till now the drugs which we have discussed, they are all oral drug. In complicated malaria, the patient will require IV drug. Now what are the drugs IV we have? What is the treatment of complicated malaria? You'll write the drug of choice for complicated malaria is artesunate. And how it must be given? It must be given IV. Okay, IV. It can be given intramuscular also, but IV artesunate is considered as a drug of choice for complicated malaria. You'll write, you can also give Artem either and RT either. Artem either and RT either. Now remember, these drugs are only given intramuscularly. They are not given IV. And the point is, this RT either is contraindicated in children. Okay? Because it causes cardiotoxicity. It is cardiotoxic. Okay? And the fourth drug you will write, which can be given IV, is quinine. Quinine is given IV in 5% dextrose solution. That means it should be given in glucose, because quinine causes a side effect of hypoglycemia. Because quinine causes hypoglycemia, hence the infusion of quinine should be given in 5% dextrose solution. Okay? Now, how to treat a complicated malaria? If a patient of complicated malaria will come, give these drugs. Let's say the drug of choice is now artesunate IV. And give this drug, you'll write first injection when the patient will come. Now, repeat this injection at 12 hours. And then repeat this injection every 24 hours, okay, or once a day, okay, till the patient accepts orally, if the patient will start accept orally, put the patient on the above oral ACT. ACT is artemisinin based combination therapy, okay, or put the patient on quinine plus clindamycin, or put the patient on quinine plus clindamycin combination. So start the normal treatment when the patient will start accepting orally, okay. So this is the treatment of complicated malaria. Now let's talk about special scenarios of malaria. Special scenarios. The first point you will write is malaria in pregnancy. Okay. Now, malaria in pregnancy, there are certain drugs which are absolutely contraindicated in whole trimester of pregnancy. The drugs which are absolutely contraindicated in pregnancies are, you will write, are PHD, that is primaquine, halofrentrine, and doxycycline. You'll write they are contraindicated in all trimesters. Okay. Now, the drug which is contraindicated only in first trimester but can be given in second and third trimester are, you will write, artemisinins, and you will write sulfadoxine pyrimethamine. Pyrimethamine, they are folic acid inhibitor. You'll write proguanil, and lastly mefloquine. okay. And the last point you will write, the safest anti-malarial, which can even be given in first trimester, and you can write all trimesters of pregnancy. Hence, they are considered as a drug of choice in pregnancy. They are either chloroquine, or quinine. So the drug of choice in malaria in pregnancy is chloroquine and quinine. Because they are the safest drug, they can be given in all trimesters of pregnancy. Okay. So how to remember? You will remember a mnemonic. You'll write PHD. PHD are contraindicated. Here you will write spam. Okay. PHD spam. So spam should not be given in first trimester. And the safest drug in malaria in pregnancy is chloroquine and quinine. So let's see what is the treatment of malaria in pregnancy. Okay. So if you talk about Vivex and Ovail. Okay. Then you will write falciparum. And lastly, you will write complicated malaria. In Vivex and Ovail, we were giving chloroquine and primaquine. Here the treatment is only and only chloroquine. Okay. Chloroquine. You'll write no primaquine, because primaquine was absolutely contraindicated in malaria. So can we say that in pregnancy, we don't give primaquine? Hence, in pregnancy, as we are not giving primaquine, there is no radical cure of malaria. We don't give radical cure of malaria in pregnancy. Okay? Because primaquine is contraindicated. Now, what about falciparum? In falciparum, in first trimester, we give quinine plus clindamycin. And in second and third trimester, we give ACT, artemisinin based combination therapy. Okay, so all these drugs are oral. But what about complicated malaria? For complicated malaria, the drug of choice is IV artesunate. Because it's a dangerous condition, we will give artesunate in all trimesters, even in first also. Because if we will not use this artesunate, the female will die due to malaria. Hence, the benefit of using this harmful drug is more in cases of complicated malaria. Okay. So overall, if somebody will ask you what is the drug of choice for malaria, the drug of choice means the safest drug is this one, that is quinine and chloroquine. Okay. So this is the treatment of malaria in pregnancy. Okay. So let's start with certain drugs now. Okay. So let's start with the drugs for malaria, anti-malarial drugs. Okay. So the anti-malarial drug, first we will start is quinolone. Sorry, first we will start is quinoline group. In quinoline group, all these drugs, they will end with the word quinine. Sorry, they will end with the word queen. Okay, so the first drug we will write, is chloroquine, the most famous drug, and we will discuss this drug in great detail. Okay, chloroquine. So let's see what is the mechanism of action of chloroquine. Suppose, sir, this is a plasmodia, and inside the plasmodia there is food vacuole. Okay, inside the food vacuole, remember, of a plasmodia, there is a pigment known as heme. Okay, and this heme gets converted into hemozoin. This hemozoin inside the food vacuole is the food for plasmodia. Okay, and this heme, remember, is toxic. And plasmodia converts heme into hemozoin. Okay, Plasmodia converts heme into hemozoin. Now what chloroquine will do? Chloroquine, it inhibits the conversion of heme into hemozoin, and this heme will kill the malaria or kill the Plasmodia. Okay, so this is the action of chloroquine and how it will kill Plasmodia. Okay, now second point, apart from this, chloroquine has additional activity. It has some additional effect. Remember, chloroquine has anti-inflammatory effect. Why chloroquine has anti-inflammatory effect? Because it inhibits interleukin-1 in humans, and it has anti-allergic effect. Why? Because it has antihistaminic property. It inhibits the release of histamine from the mast cells. Okay, it has antihistaminic property, as well as it has local anesthetic property, because on a cell membrane it inhibits sodium channel, as well as it inhibits potassium channel. It has local anesthetic property, and if this local anesthetic property comes on heart, it is known as antiarrhythmic property. It has antiarrhythmic property, and I will tell you a drug which has been approved as a local anesthetic and antiarrhythmic, we will discuss shortly, will be quinine. Quinine is a similar drug. Okay, now as it is an anti-inflammatory and anti-allergic drug, remember this chloroquine is also used in various autoimmune condition, because it will suppress inflammation, and various allergic conditions. Chloroquine is also approved as an in various autoimmune and various allergic disease. Okay, so let's see first what are the uses of chloroquine. Okay, let's see what are the uses of chloroquine. Okay, now the uses of chloroquine, you can write one mnemonic: malaria, pig. Okay, the first use of chloroquine we know is malaria. Okay, second, you will write chloroquine is also given in amoebic, liver, abscess. Chloroquine is also an approved drug for lepra reaction, which is an hypersensitivity reaction to anti-leprosy drug. It is given for an allergic condition, atopic dermatitis. Chloroquine is an approved drug for autoimmune condition known as rheumatoid arthritis. It is also given in infectious, mononucleosis. It is given in autoimmune disease like DLE. DLE stands for discoid, lupus, erythematosus. Okay, it is also given for the treatment of photosensitivity, which is also known as photomorphic light eruption. It is also known as photomorphic light eruption. It is also hypersensitivity, especially seen in females when they go into sunlight, there are skin lesions. It is given for idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. And it is also given in giardiasis. So in which protozoans it is given? Malaria, amoeba, and giardiasis. These are the three protozoans where chloroquine is effective. Other conditions are allergic and autoimmune conditions. Okay, now let's talk about the pharmacokinetics or properties of chloroquine. Okay, now what is the route of administration of chloroquine? Chloroquine is given orally, okay, and it can be rarely given IV. But nowadays we don't give IV drug because now we have other drugs. Remember, it is never given intramuscularly, okay. It is never given intramuscularly because it causes skin damage and muscle damage locally. Local tissue damage occurs. Second, when it comes into the blood, it has a plasma protein binding. Remember, chloroquine and all anti-malarial, they are basic drug and they are bound to one acidic plasma protein, alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, inside the blood. And the plasma protein binding is around 50%. That means 50% of the drug is free and it moves outside the blood vessel. Because of this reason, the volume of distribution of chloroquine is, you'll write, 1200 to 1500 liters of plasma, which is the highest volume of distribution for any known drug. So what does it mean? It has the highest volume of distribution. It means if the drug has very high volume of distribution, the drug is deposited extravascularly to different organs. So chloroquine get deposited in different organs because it does not remain mainly in the blood. It moves outside the blood vessel and gets deposited in the blood vessel. This term is known as high volume of distribution. Okay, because of this reason, because of high volume of distribution, chloroquine requires a high loading dose. Any drug which has a high volume of distribution requires a loading dose. It requires a loading dose of 600 milligram. Okay, and second point is, as it gets deposited in various organs, you'll write, it produces side effect in all organs. The side effect of chloroquine comes at all organs. Okay, side effect. So these are the properties. Now we have made a congener of chloroquine. That congener of chloroquine is hydroxychloroquine. Now hydroxychloroquine, as compared to chloroquine, is longer acting. Because of this reason, it is more preferred in autoimmune conditions like rheumatoid arthritis, etc. Now the second point with hydroxychloroquine is, hydroxychloroquine is also less toxic as compared to chloroquine, especially the eye problem. The ocular side effects of hydroxychloroquine are less as compared to chloroquine. Okay, so keeping this thing in mind, let's see the side effects of chloroquine. The side effect of chloroquine, because of high volume of distribution, comes at all organs. Okay, it comes at all organs. So let's see what are the side effects of chloroquine. Okay, so let's start with each organ. Let's start from brain, CNS. In CNS, chloroquine produces seizures or convulsions. It also produces mental changes or psychosis. Okay, then you will write eye. In eye, chloroquine gets deposited in cornea and lens. Okay, and it causes opacification. Now this opacification, remember, is reversible. As you will stop chloroquine, the coloring of lens and cornea will be reversed back. But when it gets deposited in retina, it causes irreversible retinal damage. It causes permanent damage of retina or permanent blindness. And when you will see the retina by a fundoscopy, suppose this is a retina and this is the macula in the retina. This chloroquine gets deposited in a concentric rings like this. This is the deposition of chloroquine in a concentric ring on retina. This is known as bull's eye, because this it is looking like a shooting board. That shooting board is known as bull's eye. It is known as bull's eye retinopathy. Okay, it is known as bull's eye retinopathy because it gets deposited in concentric rings. Third, you will write in ear, it is ototoxic. Okay, it causes permanent ear damage or permanent deafness. Okay, fourth, you will write it also act on CVS, cardiovascular system, on heart. It causes an arrhythmia due to increase in QT prolongation. And on blood vessel, chloroquine may produce hypotension because of vasodilatory action. Okay, on muscles, it causes myopathy. On skin, it produces discoloration. It may produce hyperpigmentation as well as hypopigmentation. It also causes graying of gray hairs. It may also cause gray hairs. Okay, lastly, in GIT, this is the most common side effect of chloroquine. It has bitter taste and it causes nausea and vomiting. Okay, so these are the various uses of chloroquine, and try to remember bull's eye maculopathy in this. Try to remember deafness or ototoxicity, QT prolongation. Okay, so try to remember, and remember all anti-malarials will have similar side effect. But what happens, some of the anti-malarial will produce more of a CNS symptom, some will produce more of a ear symptom, some will produce more of a heart symptom. Okay, so that we will be discussing, like mental changes mainly produced by mefloquine. Okay, cardiovascular changes I will be telling you mainly produced by quinine. Okay, so the frequency will vary. Okay, now the last point is, what is the cause of resistance to chloroquine? So suppose this is a plasmodia, okay, and this is a food vacuole. When chloroquine enters into the food vacuole, this chloroquine is effluxed outside or thrown outside by an efflux transporter. So resistance to chloroquine is due to efflux transporter in cases of falciparum. This efflux transporter is known as plasmodium falciparum chloroquine resistance transporter. This transporter is known as plasmodium falciparum chloroquine resistance transporter. So what is the cause of resistance to chloroquine? It is effluxed outside or it is thrown outside the cell, which leads to resistance to chloroquine to this plasmodia. But nowadays, remember, this plasmodia falciparum, it has started forming a transporter. That transporter is sometimes known as PF, plasmodium falciparum MDR. MDR stands for multi drug resistance transporter. Okay, why? Because if this transporter is formed, the chloroquine is thrown outside, quinine is thrown outside, okay, sulfadoxine pyrimethamine is thrown outside, and lastly you will write mefloquine is also thrown outside. Okay, mefloquine is also thrown outside. So can we say, if this transporter is formed, can we say that this plasmodia has become multi-drug resistant? This is known as multi-drug resistant plasmodium falciparum. because of a transporter Plasmodium falciparum MDR, multi drug resistance. If there is only chloroquine, the resistance is CRT. Okay, now the drugs which are effective against this multi drug resistance is, you will write artemisinins. Artemisinins are even effective against this, because against artemisinin right now this resistance is not developed. And the second drug you will write is lumefantrine. Artemisinin and lumefantrine are even effective in this cases. It is even effective in this cases. And this multi-drug resistant P. falciparum is seen in northeastern states of India. It is seen in northeastern states of India. That is why in northeastern states of India, we give a combination of artemisinin and lumefantrine. Okay, so this is about chloroquine, a very important drug for you. Let's see what are the other congeners of chloroquine we have. Okay, so you will write other congeners are amodiaquine, you will write tipraquine, and lastly you will write mefloquine. Now, the side effect of main amodiaquine. Amodiaquine, we know it is combined with artesunate with amodiaquine. It is a combination of ACT. It is given with artesunate with amodiaquine. It's a type of ACT. It is also given for P. falciparum malaria. The main side effect of amodiaquine is agranulocytosis, which is also known as neutropenia. Okay, if you remember piperaquine, piperaquine is also a part of ACT. It is combined with dihydroartemisinin. Or artirolane, which we have already discussed. Now, what is the main side effect of piperaquine? Same like chloroquine. Now you will write about mefloquine, a very important drug for you. Okay, mefloquine. The main side effect of mefloquine is mental changes, which you will write as neuro, behavioral, abnormality. It may also produce seizures. Because of this property of mefloquine, mefloquine is absolutely contraindicated in cerebral malaria. Okay, now the second point is mefloquine should never be combined with the similar drug of quine. It should not be combined with chloroquine. It should not be combined with quinine. Why? Because it has similar side effect. Especially their effect on heart, that is arrhythmia, could be additive, and that arrhythmia could be very dangerous. So mefloquine should not be combined with chloroquine and quinine. Mefloquine is combined with artesunate. Mefloquine is combined with artesunate, and this combination is known as ACT. Okay, and we have discussed that mefloquine is also given for prophylaxis of malaria. Now the last point you will write is mefloquine is safe in G6PD deficient people. Okay, what is this safe in G6PD deficient? That we will discuss shortly. Okay, now the next drug you will write is primaquine. Okay, we will write that primaquine is the most effective drug we have for radical cure. Okay, radical cure means to kill hypnozoite. It is the most effective drug we have for causal prophylaxis, and it is the most effective drug we have as a gametocidal agent. Okay, but this primaquine, remember, it is not effective in clinical cure. That means it cannot kill erythrocytic schizogony. It is not given for clinical cure or erythrocytic schizogony because here it is not effective. That is why this primaquine is combined with other drug. Okay. Now, what are the contraindications of primaquine? Primaquine is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy, in all trimesters. It is absolutely contraindicated in lactation, and it should not be given in infants less than 1 year of age. Okay. This primaquine is contraindicated in G6PD deficiency. Now, G6PD stands for glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency. This is an enzyme present in RBC and many other cell, because if you will give, it will form oxidative radical. It can lead to hemolysis. It can lead to hemolysis. Now, the point is, if a G6PD deficient patient will come, generally we avoid primaquine. But remember, how can we give primaquine? We can give primaquine carefully. Can give carefully. Why we need to give? Because it is the only drug which can kill radical cure and other cures of malaria, which can kill radical cure, gametocidal and causal prophylaxis. It is the only drug. So in G6PD deficiency, how we will do, how we will give primaquine? Ideally, it is contraindicated, but if we want to give, then how we will give? You will give this drug once a week. Okay, once a week for 8 weeks with careful monitoring for hemolysis. We should keep on checking the blood count again and again. So in G6PD deficiency, primaquine can be given very carefully once a week for 8 weeks, not continuously for 14 days, remember, and monitoring for hemolysis. Okay. Now we have a similar new drug which can be given in these condition. Okay, specially, but right now this drug has been approved for radical cure, that is tefinaquine. Tefinaquine has recently been approved for radical cure of malaria. Recently been approved, just like primaquine. Okay, so these are the quinolone derivatives. Now the second group of drug we will write is cinchona alkaloid. Cinchona alkaloids in malaria. Among cinchona alkaloid, we have two drug. You'll write quinine, and the D isomer of quinine known as quinidine. And the D isomer of quinine, quinidine. Okay, this quinine, it was the first drug for malaria. It was the first drug for malaria, and it was obtained from a bark of cinchona plant, cinchona autumnal plant, sorry, cinchona plant. Okay. Now, you'll write it's a very rapidly acting drug. Okay. And hence it is combined with doxycycline or clindamycin. Why? Because they are slow acting drugs. Because they are slow acting drug. So we combine this quinine with these drugs. Now let's talk about the pharmacokinetics of quinine. This quinine, remember, in plasma, it is bound to, just like chloroquine, bound to alpha 1 acid glycoprotein. Okay, plasma protein. Now remember, if you give sudden high dose of chloroquine, in high dose of chloroquine, generally there is no toxicity seen. The reason is, there is no toxicity seen in high dose of quinine because this alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, it increases in malaria. The level of alpha 1 acid glycoprotein in malaria increases, and there will be more binding of quinine to alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, and hence it will not become free. Because this alpha 1 acid glycoprotein is a type of acute phase reactant. Now, acute phase reactants are those molecules which are increased in our body when there is some infection or inflammation. And quinine binds to this plasma protein. There is high level of plasma protein, so if you will give higher dose of quinine, more it will bind to alpha 1 acid glycoprotein. Okay. Now, if you talk about the side effect of quinine, the side effect of quinine is known as synconism. Synconism. Okay. The most common side effect in synconism, the main side effect is seen as CNS side effect. Okay. Because it is obtained from cinchona plant. So the side effect which is seen in synconism is, you will write headache or seizures. Okay. You will write it is highly ototoxic, just like chloroquine, and it may also cause nystagmus. Okay. The second side effect of quinine you will write is GIT. In GIT, it causes diarrhea. And diarrhea overall is the most common side effect of quinine. The most common side effect of quinine is diarrhea. Third, you will write on heart, it causes increase in QT prolongation. Why? It blocks potassium channel on heart. Okay, and on blood vessels, it produces hypotension. Because it dilates blood vessel. And fourth, you will write, it produces hypoglycemia. It produces hypoglycemia. Why? Because it blocks potassium channel on beta cell of pancreas. Okay. Because if you will block potassium channel on beta cell of pancreas, it release insulin. And due to hypoglycemia, the patient have symptoms of sweating, palpitations, tremors, etc. Okay. That is why quinine, it is also given, always given IV in 5% dextrose solution. It should always be given in dextrose solution. Okay. Now, apart from quinine, let's see the uses of quinine now. Now, quinine, it is used in malaria. Quinine, it is used in malaria, and you will write, it is a safe drug in pregnancy. That we have already discussed. Second point you will write, quinine, it is also an anti-arrhythmic drug. It is class 1A anti-arrhythmic drug, and quinine, it is also given in nocturnal leg cramps. Nocturnal leg cramps. So these are the three uses of quinine. Okay. The three uses of quinine is malaria, antiarrhythmic drug, and nocturnal leg cramps. Okay. So try to remember them. Now let's talk about other drugs. You'll write halofentrine and lumefantrine. okay, they are alcohols which are used in their chemical structures, alcohols. Okay, now remember, their main side effect is they are cardiotoxic. What they will cause in cardiotoxicity? Remember, they cause conduction defect. They cause conduction defect. Okay. Now remember, halofrentine is contraindicated in pregnancy, in all trimester. Lumefrentine can be given in second and third trimester. It can be given. And this lumefrentine, remember, it is given in northeastern states of India. Why? Because it is even effective in MDR malaria. MDR is multi-drug resistance malaria that we have already discussed. Okay. Now the next group we have is artemisinin group. Artemisinins. Now this artemisinin is a major breakthrough in the treatment of malaria. Okay. It's a major breakthrough. The reason is, it is also effective in MDR cases of malaria, and malaria has become multi-drug resistant in many parts of the world. Okay. Now this artemisinins, remember, they are derived from a Chinese herb. Okay, that Chinese herb name is Artemisinin annua. Okay, Artemisinin annua. Now the point is, this artemisinin, it is insoluble in water and oil. Hence, we cannot use it. So the drugs which we have made among artemisinin is a modification of artemisinin. Modified forms of artemisinins are used. Okay. So the drugs among artemisinin groups we have are, you will write, artesunate, okay, dihydroartesunate, artemether, artether, and artirolane. So these are the drugs which we have, and there is a drug which is right now under a clinical trial, but right now that drug hasn't been approved. The name of that drug, the name of the drug which right now hasn't been approved, is artefenomel. Right now it is not approved. Just for your reference, you will write this. So these are the drugs which are approved. Let's see their route of administration. Okay. Now, if you talk about the route of administration, you'll write, they all can be given orally. Okay, all are given orally. Now let's see what are the other routes. This artesunate is given IV. No other drug can be given IV. It can be given rectally. No other drug can be given rectally. And lastly, it can be given intramuscularly. There are two drugs which are given intramuscularly, are artemether and artemether. Okay, so artesunate hence becomes the most commonly used drug because it is given by all routes. Okay, and the two drugs which can be given as an intramuscular injection is artemether and artemether, and these injections, hence, they are given for complicated malaria. Injectable drugs are given for complicated malaria. Hence, the drug of choice for complicated malaria we have discussed is artemisinins. Now, let's talk about the properties of artemisinin. आर्टेमिस निंस दे आर द फास्टेस्ट मोस्ट इफेक्टिव एंड मोस्ट पोटेंट ड्रग फॉर क्लोरोक्वीन रेजिस्टेंट मलेरिया. दे आर द बेस्ट ड्रग वी हैव फॉर क्लोरोक्वीन रेजिस्टेंट मलेरिया बिकॉज दे आर द फास्टेस्ट एक्टिंग ड्रग, दे आर द मोस्ट इफेक्टिव ड्रग एंड दे आर द मोस्ट पोटेंट ड्रग फॉर क्लोरोक्वीन रेजिस्टेंट मलेरिया. ओके, नाउ द पॉइंट इज अनफॉर्चुनेटली दे हैव नो इफेक्ट ऑन रेडिकल क्योर, नो इफेक्ट ऑन रेडिकल क्योर. दे आर गिवन फॉर क्लिनिकल क्योर. सो इन विच फेज वी गिव, वी गिव देम इन क्लिनिकल क्योर. नाउ रिमेंबर एस आर्टेमिसिनिंस आर द फास्टेस्ट एक्टिंग ड्रग, एस दे आर द फास्टेस्ट एक्टिंग ड्रग, रिमेंबर दे आर नेवर गिवन फॉर प्रोफाइलेक्सिस, दे आर नेवर गिवन फॉर प्रोफाइलेक्सिस ऑफ मलेरिया बिकॉज फॉर प्रोफाइलेक्सिस ऑफ मलेरिया यू नीड अ लॉन्ग एक्टिंग ड्रग, फॉर प्रोफाइलेक्सिस यू नीड अ लॉन्ग एक्टिंग ड्रग. सेकेंड पॉइंट, एज दे आर द वेरी फास्ट एक्टिंग ड्रग दे मे कॉज इनकम्प्लीट किलिंग ऑफ प्लाज्मोडिया, दे मे कॉज इनकम्प्लीट किलिंग एंड इनकम्प्लीट किलिंग कैन कॉज रिक्रूडिसेंस विच वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड, दे मे कॉज रिक्रूडिसेंस. ओके, बिकॉज ऑफ दिस रीजन, बिकॉज दे आर कॉजिंग इनकम्प्लीट किलिंग, दे आर वेरी फास्ट एक्टिंग ड्रग, दे आर ऑलवेज कंबाइंड विद अ स्लो एक्टिंग ड्रग, स्लो और लॉन्ग एक्टिंग ड्रग. एंड वाई वी कंबाइन देम विद स्लो और लॉन्ग एक्टिंग ड्रग, टू प्रिवेंट दिस रिक्रूडिसेंस ऑफ मलेरिया. एंड दिस कॉम्बिनेशन इज नोन एज ACT, which I believe we have already discussed, artemisinin-based combination therapy. Okay, artemisinin-based combination therapy. So that is why they are always combined with other drugs. Now, what are the side effects of artemisinin? The most common side effect of artemisinin is nausea and vomiting. And sometimes they may produce dangerous anaphylactic reactions. Sometimes they may produce, artemisinins may produce dangerous anaphylactic reactions. So that is why, as they cause incomplete killing, they are very fast acting drug, they are never given for prophylaxis. They may cause incomplete killing, which is known as recrudescence. Hence they are combined with a long acting or a slow acting drug. This is known as artemisinin based combination therapy. Okay, so let's see what are the lastly miscellaneous drugs we have for malaria, miscellaneous drugs for malaria. So the first drug we have is folic acid inhibitors, okay. These drugs, they inhibit one enzyme, DHFR enzyme, that is dihydrofolate reductase. This enzyme is required for conversion of folic acid into its active form. The active form of folic acid is tetrahydrofolate, because this tetrahydrofolate can take part in chemical reaction. So the drugs are, there are two drugs, you will write proguanil, and the second drug is pyrimethamine. Okay, proguanil and pyrimethamine. Okay, the first point you will write with these drugs, both of these drugs, they are slow acting drug. They are very slow acting drugs. Second point you will write, these drugs, they are always combined. This proguanil is always combined with a drug known as atovaquon. And this pyrimethamine is combined with a drug known as sulfadoxine. Okay, so proguanil is combined with atovaquon, pyrimethamine is combined with sulfadoxine, because this combination is a synergistic combination. it increases each other's effectiveness. Okay, it increases each other's effectiveness. Now the third point you will write, the proguanil is combined with atovaquone, pyrimethamine is combined with sulfadoxine. Now remember, it is given, it is approved in Africa, USA, America, that means outside India. Remember, it is the main drug of choice as an ACT in India. It is given in India as ACT, artemisinin based combination therapy. So in all states of India, we give artesunate with sulfadoxine pyrimethamine combination. Okay, now what about the side effect of these drugs? Both of these drugs, their side effect is folic acid deficiency. And for the treatment of folic acid deficiency of both of these drugs, the drug of choice, we must always combine these drugs with a drug known as folinic acid. Both of these drugs, they cause folic acid deficiency, and we combine these drugs with folinic acid. What is folinic acid? Folinic acid is the active form of folic acid, that is formyl tetrahydrofolate. So if folic acid deficiency occurs, we give this tetrahydrofolate from outside because they have inhibited dihydrofolate reductase enzyme, and these drugs, they cause folic acid deficiency. For the treatment of folic acid deficiency, give folinic acid from outside, which is the active form. Okay, so remember this part. Now let's see what are the other drugs we have. So other drugs, we will just write the list, that is pyrronaridine is not given in India. It is sometimes given in China country. You write antibiotics like doxycycline, which is a tetracycline group of antibiotic, or clindamycin. These two antibiotics, they are combined with, that is quinine. Okay, doxycycline is contraindicated in children less than 8 years of age and pregnancy, while clindamycin is safe drug. It can be given in children and it can be given in pregnant female for the treatment of malaria. So this is all about the drugs of malaria. Okay, so now we will start with amebiasis. Okay, now amebiasis is a protozoan infection which is caused by a protozoa known as Entamoeba histolytica. Okay, Entamoeba histolytica. And how it is spread? The transmission of Entamoeba histolytica is through orofecal route. Now let's see how the infections of amebiasis occurs. So if a person eats the cysts are the infective form of amebiasis protozoa. This cyst, they come into the intestine. Now suppose these are the cells of intestine. These cysts, remember, first time, the first stage of amebiasis, it will not invade the intestinal cell, it will remain on the surface of intestinal cell. This is known as luminal amebiasis. So in luminal amebiasis, the patient is asymptomatic, but this patient is a chronic cyst passer. That means chronically the cyst will be passed into the feces and the other people will be infected also. This is known as luminal amebiasis. Now what happens further? This luminal amebiasis, it invades into the cells of intestine. Okay, it invades into the cells of intestine and it create ulcers. It will create ulcers or flask shaped ulcer,
When it invades into the cells of intestine, this is known as tissue or invasive amoebiasis. Tissue or invasive amoebiasis. Now, what will happen? First of all, it will invade intestinal cells and it will cause flask-shaped ulcer inside the intestinal cell, and the patient will, in cases of intestinal amoebiasis, the patient will suffer from a disease known as amoebic dysentery, because the blood bleeding will occur and the blood will be passed out in urine. Now, from this intestine, this amoeba, it will go to other organ, it will invade further and it will go to other organs, especially like liver. Okay, so if it will go outside the intestine, it is known as extra intestinal amoebiasis. It is known as extra intestinal amoebiasis. Here the most common symptom a patient will suffer from is hepatic amoebic abscess, which could be very dangerous condition. Okay, so hepatic amoebic abscess. So can we say that we have discussed three stages of amoebiasis? One is luminal amoebiasis, which is asymptomatic state, amoebic dysentery, which is known as intestinal amoebiasis, and extra intestinal, the most common manifestation is hepatic amoebic abscess. Now let's see what are the drugs we have for these three stages. Let's see the drugs we have for luminal amoebiasis and the drugs we have for these amoebiasis. The drug for luminal amoebiasis, the drug of choice is, you will write, paromomycin. The drug of choice for luminal amoebiasis is paromomycin. It's an aminoglycoside which is not absorbed orally. Okay, but what are the other drugs? You will write PNDTH. Okay, PNDTH. So PNDT is an act. N for nitazoxanide. D for diloxanide furoate. T for tetracycline. And lastly, you will write hydroxyquinolines. Among hydroxyquinolines, we have two drugs you will write. The first drug you will write is quinodochlor. And the second drug you will write is iodoquinol. Quinodochlor is also known as quino, you will write clio, quinol. Okay, so these are the drugs which will kill luminal amoebiasis. They are not effective in intestinal or extra intestinal stage. Now the drug of choice for both amoebic dysentery and hepatic amoebic abscess, the drug of choice is metronidazole. And the congeners of metronidazole, this group is known as nitroimidazole. Okay, but there is one more drug which you can use, is emetine. But emetine is a highly toxic drug, hence the drug of choice for amoebic dysentery and hepatic amoebic abscess is metronidazole. Okay, that is metronidazole. Earlier we use a drug emetine. Now there is one drug which can be given as an add-on drug. That add-on drug is chloroquine. Now remember, chloroquine is just an add-on drug only in cases of hepatic amoebic abscess. Only in cases of hepatic amoebic abscess. Remember, chloroquine is not effective. Chloroquine is not effective in cases of amoebic dysentery. It is only given in hepatic amoebic abscess, while in both cases the drug of choice is metronidazole. While chloroquine is only given in hepatic amoebic abscess. Earlier, a drug which can be given in both cases was emetine. So this is the complete list of the drugs which are given in amoebiasis. So let's start with all individual drugs one by one. Okay. So the first drug we have is metronidazole. Okay. Metronidazole. So it is a drug of choice for both amoebic dysentery and it is also the drug of choice for hepatic amoebic abscess. Now, what is the dose of metronidazole in amoebic dysentery? The dose of metronidazole in amoebic dysentery is 400 milligram TDS. TDS is 3 times a day for 5 to 7 days. Okay. While in amoebic abscess, we have to give higher dose, that is 800 milligram 3 times a day for 7 to 10 days. Okay. So this is the dose of metronidazole. Okay. Now in hepatic amoebic abscess, we add chloroquine to it. Okay. Chloroquine 600 mg. Okay. Only in cases of hepatic amoebic abscess, chloroquine is not effective in amoebic dysentery. Now the point you have to write is, what is the drawback? Remember, metronidazole is not effective in luminal amoebiasis. Why? Because when metronidazole is given orally or IV, when it is given orally, it is completely absorbed. It is completely absorbed from upper part of duodenum. As it is completely absorbed from upper part of duodenum, it will not reach into the small intestine and colon. Hence, the luminal amoebiasis mainly reside in the later part of small intestine and colon. So it is not effective. And the last point is, precaution should be taken in alcoholics. Because metronidazole-like drug in alcoholics causes disulfiram-like reaction and amoebiasis very commonly occurs in alcoholics. Okay? So precaution should be taken in cases of alcoholics. Now the second drug we have is emetine. Now emetine, what is the mechanism of action? The exact mechanism we don't know, but it inhibits protein synthesis. Okay? Now this emetine is highly effective against, it kills trophozoites. Okay, it only kills trophozoite. Trophozoite is present inside the invaded cells. When the amoebiasis invades into the cell of intestine and liver, it is trophozoite. But it is not effective in, it cannot kill cyst. Remember, cyst is present in luminal amoebiasis. So it is the drug which is only given to kill trophozoite. In cases of tissue or invasive amoebiasis, it is not effective, just like metronidazole, in cases of luminal amoebiasis. Now the point is, what is the importance of emetine? Emetine is an add-on drug in resistant cases of metronidazole. Okay, metronidazole. Now what is the side effect? The side effect of emetine is it causes emesis when it is given orally. That is why it got its name emetine. Okay, because of this reason, it is never given orally. It is always given as an injection. Okay, it is always given as an injection, and even in injection, it produces emesis. Even in injection, it can produce emesis. Now, the second point you will write, it is highly cardiotoxic and it is contraindicated in pregnancy. So, amoebiasis in pregnancy, emetine is contraindicated. In pregnancy, the drug of choice is again metronidazole. So, amoebiasis in pregnancy, again, the drug of choice is metronidazole. emetine is absolutely contraindicated. Okay, so now let's talk about luminal amebia. Luminal luminal amebiasis or amebicides. So the first drug you will write, these drugs, they will kill cyst which is present in lumen of the amoeba. So the first drug is paromomycin. Paromomycin is a aminoglycoside, and this aminoglycoside is given in various protozoan infection. This paromomycin aminoglycoside is given in various protozoan infection. Now remember, aminoglycoside, they are not absorbed orally. They are not absorbed orally. Okay, so because of this reason, first use of paromomycin is oral paromomycin. As it is not given absorbed orally, it is given for luminal amebiasis. The reason is the amebiasis is present only in the lumen, so it will go and kill the amoeba in the lumen and it will be ejected out in feces. But it can be given IV for the treatment of Kala Azar. It can be given for the treatment of Kala Azar IV, Leishmania donovani. Remember, it can be given topically as a 15% cream for cutaneous leishmaniasis. Okay, it can be given topically for cutaneous leishmaniasis. Okay, so try to remember. Now the next drug we have is nitazoxanide. Now nitazoxanide again is a broad spectrum drug. It's a broad spectrum drug. Okay, now where it is given, remember, nitazoxanide is the drug of choice for a protozoa known as Cryptosporidium parvum infection. Now Cryptosporidium parvum, it causes diarrhea in HIV patients. Diarrhea in HIV patient, it is a drug of choice. Okay, but it is also given in cases of, it is also given in cases of, you will write, other protozoa like GENT. It is also given in giardiasis. It is given in entamoeba, histolytica, as a luminal amebicidal agent. Okay, and it is also given in a protozoa known as Trichomonas vaginalis infection. It is also given in Trichomonas vaginalis infection. So these are the three uses, but remember, nitazoxanide is a drug of choice for Cryptosporidium parvum infection. Okay, now the point is, what is the mechanism of action of nitazoxanide? Nitazoxanide, it inhibit one enzyme present in protozoa known as P4 enzyme. P4 stand for pyruvate, ferritin, oxidoreductase, and this enzyme is required for energy production. So it reduces the energy production inside the protozoa. Okay, so it is a drug of choice for Cryptosporidium parvum infection, but it is given in other protozoa, giardiasis, entamoeba and Trichomonas. But remember, here the drug of choice in all protozoa is metronidazole. In these three protozoa, the drug of choice is metronidazole. But metronidazole, remember, is not effective in one protozoa known as Cryptosporidium parvum. So in Cryptosporidium parvum protozoa, metronidazole is not effective. Here the drug of choice is nitazoxanide. Okay, now the third drug you will write is diloxanide furate. okay. Now in diloxonide furate, this furate ester, it kills the protozoa, it kills the cyst of protozoa, okay. That is why it is given in luminal amoebicidal agent. So in this, the furate esters, it directly kills the protozoa. Now what is the side effect? The side effect is flatulence. So remember, furate ester is the active moiety and the side effect is flatulence. Hence it is only given in luminal amoebiasis. It is not given in tissue amoebiasis. Okay, tissue amoebiasis. Now the fourth drug you will write is quinodochlor and iodoquinol. Okay, now quinodochlor is also known as clioquinol. Now this drug produces a very dangerous side effect. The dangerous side effect of quinodochlor is SMON, that stands for subacute myelo-optic neuritis. Okay, now it may cause permanent blindness. It may cause permanent blindness. Because of this reason, they are nowadays not used. Nowadays they are now not used. And what about iodoquinol? Iodoquinol produces a side effect known as iodism. Why? Because it contains iodine. Okay, in iodism, the patient will suffer from skin infection, skin inflammation known as furuncle, and inflammation of mucous membrane. Mucous membrane and salivary glands, which mimics like mumps. It causes furuncle and inflammation of these membranes. Okay, so these are the drawbacks of these drugs. So this is all about amoebiasis. Now let's talk about next protozoa, that is trypanosoma. Trypanosoma. Now trypanosoma causes two types of infection. One is African type, second is South American type. Okay, second is South American type. The African type of infection, which occurs in Africa by trypanosoma, this infection is known as sleeping sickness. This infection is known as sleeping sickness. And the infection caused by trypanosoma in South American type is known as Chagas disease. Okay, Chagas disease. Now this sleeping sickness of trypanosoma is spread by a bite of a mosquito that is known as tsetse fly. It's spread by a mosquito bite, tsetse fly. And Chagas disease is due to a bite of a bug. That bug is known as triatomine bug. Okay, now which species of trypanosoma causes? The species of trypanosoma which causes sleeping sickness is known as Trypanosoma brucei. Trypanosoma brucei. And here the species is Trypanosoma cruzi. Trypanosoma cruzi. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. Now the drug of choice for the treatment of Chagas disease is benznidazole. Okay, that is a better drug as compared to nifurtimox. The drug of choice for South American type or Chagas disease is benznidazole, which is a better drug as compared to nifurtimox. These drugs are just like metronidazole. They are just like metronidazole. okay, so try to remember. Now let's talk about the treatment of sleeping sickness. The treatment of sleeping sickness, remember, it is further of two type. Trypanosoma brucei, it has two subspecies which causes different type of infection. The one is West African type, second is East African type. Okay, the West African type of Trypanosoma brucei, the species is Trypanosoma brucei, subspecies Gambiense, and Trypanosoma brucei Rhodesiense. Okay, Rhodesiense. Now, these infections, they have two stages. One is an early stage. In early stage, these promastigate forms of these Trypanosoma or protozoa, they remain in blood, which is known as hemolymphatic stage. And then it comes into a late stage. So this late stage has 100% mortality. The patient dies. More than 95% or up to 100% mortality, because it goes into CNS, and in CNS it has 100% mortality. Very dangerous condition. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. So the drugs we have for West African type or Trypanosoma brucei gambiense, in early stage the drug of choice is pentamidine. In early stage of East African or Rhodesiense, the drug of choice is Suramin. Now, in late stage of Gambiense, the drug of choice is NECT therapy. NECT stand for Nifurtimox with eflornithine. CT stand for combination therapy. Okay, that is NECT therapy. NECT stand for Nifurtimox eflornithine combination therapy. Okay, this is the treatment of the late stage of Gambiense. And if you talk about Rhodesiense, we have only and only one drug. There is no other drug apart from this drug, that is Milarsoprol. It is the only drug we have, Milarsoprol. Okay, so this is the treatment of Trypanosoma infection. Okay, West African type, East African type. Okay, so let's talk about these drugs one by one, these four drugs. So let's start with the first drug, that is pentamidine. Okay, let's talk about pentamidine. Pentamidine, by some unknown mechanism, it causes DNA damage of protozoa. Okay, use pentamidine is given IV, it is not given orally, and it is given in sleeping sickness, which we have just discussed. Sleeping sickness, it is can be given in cases of Kala Azar also, but in Kala Azar it is not approved in India. Okay, it is not approved in India. While this can be given IV, it can be given by aerosols or IV in cases of an infection known as pneumocystis infection. Pneumocystis jeroveci infection. Okay, pentamidine. Now, what is the side effect of pentamidine? This is very important. Pentamidine causes hypotension. And pentamidine causes hypoglycemia. Okay, and this condition could be fatal. Many cases of death have been reported because of hypotension and hypoglycemia. And it also causes pancreatitis or pancreas damage. And due to pancreas damage, remember, it causes hyperglycemia in long term. okay? Because of this reason, it is contraindicated in diabetes mellitus patient. So it may cause direct hypoglycemia, and due to pancreatic damage, it may cause hyperglycemia. Okay, so try to remember. Now the next drug we have is F-lornithine. F-lornithine, the mechanism of action is it inhibits ornithine decarboxylase enzyme. How it inhibits? Irreversibly. It's an irreversible inhibitor of ornithine decarboxylase enzyme. Okay, so where it is used? We know it is given as a NECT therapy in cases of sleeping sickness late stage. Okay, now this F-lornithine is given topically as well. So how it is given? It is also given IV. Okay, only IV. Now this F-lornithine, remember, it is given topically, and it is given topically as a hair remover, which is also known as topical de-epilator. That means it removes hair from the skin. Because of this reason, this F-lornithine has been approved for the treatment of hirsutism. It has been approved for the treatment of hirsutism because it is a topical hair remover cream. Okay. Now, what are the other drugs? You will write Suramin. Okay. It is an IV drug, and we know it is given in early stages. And the last drug is Milarsoprol. Now, Milarsoprol is the only drug we have for late stage or CNS stage of East African type of sleeping sickness. Okay. Now, what is the mechanism of action? It contains ARS. ARS means arsenic. It contains arsenic, and arsenic causes oxidative damage. Arsenic causes oxidative damage. Its main side effect is it may cause meningoencephalitis, and the patient may die due to the use of Milarsoprol. It's a very dangerous drug, but it is still used because we are out of option in this late stage, because in late stage we don't have any other drug. Okay, so these are the drugs we have for treatment of trypanosoma. Now let's talk about the next protozoa, that is Leishmania. Okay, Leishmania. Now Leishmania, it is a protozoa. It causes two types of infection. One is known as visceral leishmaniasis, and other infection. Okay. Now, other infections caused by Leishmania are, you will write cutaneous leishmaniasis, mucocutaneous leishmaniasis, and diffuse cutaneous leishmaniasis. Okay, diffuse cutaneous leishmaniasis. Now this leishmaniasis, it is due to a bite of a mosquito known as sandfly mosquito. Okay, due to bite of a sandfly mosquito. Remember, it is endemic in India, in North India, especially in the cases of Bihar. Okay, and the point is, the treatment of leishmaniasis is given by a program which is under a malaria, National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program. Okay, and the last point with leishmania is an opportunistic infection in HIV patients. Leishmania is an opportunistic infection in HIV patients. Now let's talk about these leishmaniasis. Okay, Now, visceral leishmaniasis is mainly caused by Leishmania donovani. Okay, and this leishmaniasis, they are caused by other species like Leishmania tropica, Leishmania brasiliensis, etc. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have for visceral. Remember, this visceral leishmaniasis is a fatal disease unless not treatable. If you will not treat this visceral leishmaniasis, it is a fatal disease. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. Okay, so the drugs, we can divide it into topical and systemic. So in visceral leishmaniasis, we give systemic drugs. So there are four drugs which are approved in India. You'll write SAR-MAPS. In visceral leishmaniasis, it is MAPS. Now just remember, this visceral leishmaniasis is also known as Kala Azar. Visceral leishmaniasis is also known as Kala Azar. So the drugs for Kala Azar are, you will write MAPS. That is, you will write, the first drug you will write is Miltefosine, Amphotericin B, Paromomycin, and Sodium Stibogluconate. So these are the four drugs which are approved in India for the treatment of Kala Azar in India. So the drugs which are not approved for the treatment of visceral leishmaniasis or Kala Azar in India, you will write is SAP. That is Sitamaquine, Allopurinol. Remember, Allopurinol is effective against Kala Azar, and Pentamidine. Okay, Pentamidine. Now for topical, we have to give topical drugs. And this is caused by cutaneous leishmaniasis. This infection is sometimes known as oriental sore. This infection is also known as oriental sore. So these topical drugs are four: SAPP. Okay, SAPP, you will write sodium stibogluconate. You'll write amphotericin B, paromomycin, and pentamidine. Now remember, for topical leishmaniasis, the drug of choice is sodium stibogluconate. Okay, for topical leishmaniasis, cutaneous leishmaniasis, or oriental sore, the drug of choice is sodium stibogluconate. Okay, and in Kala Azar, the drug of choice is amphotericin B. In Kala Azar, the drug of choice is amphotericin B, and in cutaneous leishmaniasis, the drug of choice is sodium stibogluconate. Now, why there is not sodium stibogluconate here? Because there is widespread resistance to sodium stibogluconate. Okay, so let's see what is the treatment of Kala Azar in great detail. So, treatment of Kala Azar or visceral leishmaniasis caused by Leishmania donovanosis, it is given by a program, National Vector Borne Disease Control Program. Okay, now what is the drug? Remember, the drug of choice for Kala Azar is, you'll write liposomal amphotericin B. Liposomal amphotericin B. How to give? You will write as a single dose. You will write, it is given as a 10 milligram per kg IV, single dose. It is considered as a drug of choice. So if it is not available, because it's a very costly drug, then use these drugs in the order of preference. Use these drugs in the order of preference. This is the order of preference. Second is the most preferred drug. Okay. So the second drug you will write is combination of miltefosine, which is an oral drug, with paromomycin. Paromomycin is given as an injection for 10 days. If this is not available, then the next preference you will write is amphotericin B. Amphotericin B emulsion. Amphotericin B emulsion. If it is not given the option, then you will go only and only with miltefosine. Okay. Now the point is, amphotericin B emulsion, it should be given for 30 days. Miltefosine, it should be given for 28 days, 100 milligram of the dose. Okay. 100 milligram here, 1 milligram per kg. Okay. 1 milligram per kg. Here you'll write, if miltefosine is not given, then the last option you will give is sodium stibogluconate. Okay, sodium stibogluconate. Sodium stibogluconate is given as a 20 milligram per kg dose, you must remember. Okay, per day for 30 days as an injection, either IV or IM. Okay, so this is the treatment. So the most preferred agent for treatment of Kala Azar, which is considered as a drug of choice, is liposomal amphotericin B as a single dose of 10 milligram per kg. The least preferred agent is sodium stibogluconate. Why it is least preferred? Because of widespread resistance. There is a resistance up to 60%. 60% of the cases have become now resistant to sodium stibogluconate. Okay. Now there is a complication of visceral leishmaniasis known as post Kala Azar dermal leishmaniasis. Okay. Post Kala Azar dermal leishmaniasis. If this complication arises due to Kala Azar, remember the drug of choice is oral miltefosine. Orally. But remember, this miltefosine, it is an anti-cancer drug or highly teratogenic drug. It is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. It is absolutely contraindicated in children less than 1 year, and the resistance to miltefosine develops commonly. In this cases, the drug of choice is same liposomal amphotericin B. If these cases are specifically mentioned, then the drug of choice is liposomal amphotericin B. But overall, the drug of choice for post Kala Azar dermal leishmaniasis is miltefosine. Okay. So these are the drugs. So let's talk about certain drugs. So let's make a summary of this drug. Let's make a summary and then we will write the specific point. So can we say the drug of choice for visceral leishmaniasis or Kala Azar is liposomal AMB, amphotericin B? Okay, you will write drug of choice for post Kala Azar dermal leishmaniasis is oral miltefosine. Okay. Now the drug of choice for cutaneous leishmaniasis is sodium stibogluconate. Okay, the drug of choice for cutaneous leishmaniasis is sodium stibogluconate. You will write the only oral drug for Kala Azar. The only oral drug for Kala Azar is miltefosine. Miltefosine is the only oral drug we have for Kala Azar. No other drug we have. All other drugs apart from miltefosine are injectable drug for Kala Azar. But right now there is a new drug which is under trial, which is also an oral drug for Kala Azar, that is sitamaquine. Sitamaquine is a potential new oral drug, but right now it is not approved. So the only oral drug right now we have for the treatment of Kala Azar is miltefosine. Okay, so let's talk about these drug one by one. So let's first talk about miltefosine. This miltefosine has a very interesting history. It was developed as an anti-cancer drug. Okay, but now it is not used in cancer. It is given in Kala Azar. But because it is an anti-cancer drug, remember it is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. Why? Because it is highly teratogenic. Highly teratogenic. So in pregnancy, the drug of choice is liposomal amphotericin B. Okay, in pregnancy for Kala Azar, the drug of choice is liposomal amphotericin B. Now the next drug we have is sodium stibogluconate. Sodium stibogluconate. Now sodium stibogluconate, remember it's a pentavalent antimonial. Now what do we mean by antimonial? Antimonial means it contains antimony. Antimony is an element with a chemical symbol of Sb. And pentavalent means it contains 5. This is what we mean by pentavalent antimonial. Now this pentavalent antimonial inside the leishmania, it gets converted into Sb3+. And this Sb3+ kills leishmania. It kills leishmania. Okay, so inside the leishmania it will be converted into Sb3+, and Sb3+ convert, it directly kills leishmania. Okay, we know it is a drug of choice for cutaneous leishmaniasis. But what about visceral or Kala Azar? In visceral or Kala Azar, remember there is 60% or widespread resistance in India. Hence, it is now less preferred. Okay, less preferred. What is the side effect of antimonial like sodium stibogluconate? The side effect you will write is it causes pancreatitis. Okay, it causes QT prolongation and it causes nephrotoxicity. So, how to remember PQN? Three alphabet in same order. Okay, so try to remember PQN. So this is about sodium stibogluconate. So it is still given in cutaneous leishmaniasis, but in Kala Azar there is widespread resistance. So this completes our leishmania. So let's talk about now all other miscellaneous protozoan infection. Okay, let's talk about all other miscellaneous protozoan infection. So the first infection you will write is Trichomonas vaginalis. Trichomonas vaginalis, it causes itchy green colored vaginal discharge. Now the drug of choice for Trichomonas vaginalis is metronidazole, or you can use, which is considered as a drug of choice, or you can use tinidazole. Both are exactly same drug. What is the dose? You will write 2 grams single dose. Both are equally effective drug. Okay, so it is considered as a drug of choice. Remember, it is always mandatory to treat sexual partner as well. Treat sexual partner as well. And remember, now no topical drug should be given. No topical drug should be given for Trichomonas vaginalis. Okay, and it is safe in pregnancy also. This metronidazole is safe in pregnancy as a single dose, no problem. So it is considered as a drug of choice for Trichomonas vaginalis infection. Let's come to the next infection, protozoan infection, that is giardiasis. So giardiasis is caused by Giardia intestinalis or Giardia lambia. Remember, it causes diarrhea, especially in HIV positive individuals. Okay. Now, what is the treatment of giardiasis? The drug of choice for giardiasis is, you will write, single dose tinidazole is now considered as a drug of choice for giardiasis. Okay. Which is better than, it is considered as a drug of choice, which is better than metronidazole for 5 days. Metronidazole for 5 days. So it's a better drug. Okay. Now remember, these drugs should not be given in pregnancy. In pregnancy, the treatment of giardiasis is oral. The drug of choice is oral paromomycin. Okay, that is the drug of choice for giardiasis in pregnancy. And another drug which has been approved is nitazoxanide. Nitazoxanide is another drug. But the drug of choice for giardiasis is single dose tinidazole. But in pregnancy, it should be paromomycin, because oral paromomycin is not absorbed. Let's come to the third protozoan, that is Toxoplasma. Toxoplasma gondii. Okay. Now for Toxoplasma, remember, it is spread through feline or cats. The drug of choice for toxoplasmosis is sulfadiazine with pyrimethamine combination. Okay. Now we know that pyrimethamine causes folic acid deficiency. You must add folinic acid to it. So these three agents should be given. Okay. Now, as we know that sulfa may cause allergic reaction, sulfa drugs, they may cause allergic reaction. If there is allergy to sulfa, remember, replace this sulfa and add with pyrimethamine clindamycin. If this the patient is having sulfa allergy, add clindamycin. Okay. But remember, if this toxoplasmosis occurs in pregnancy, this toxoplasma can cross placenta and it may cause congenital malformation or developmental delay in fetus. The fetus will be malformed. So in pregnancy of toxoplasma, the drug of choice is spiramycin. Now why spiramycin? Spiramycin gets concentrated in placenta. Spiramycin, it gets concentrated in placenta and it prevent transmission of toxoplasma. It prevents the transmission of toxoplasma. But remember, if fetal infection has occurred, that you have done amniocentesis and you have seen if fetal toxoplasma infection has already occurred. Okay, then you must start sulfadiazine plus pyrimethamine plus clindamycin. Okay, in pregnant females, you must start this drug in pregnant females, and you must give this drug when the child is born, newborn child, for 1 year. Okay, if this infection has already occurred, how you will do? You will do amniocentesis, take out the amniotic fluid, and you will see, do diagnostic test, amniocentesis, then you will start this drug. Okay. So overall, the drug of choice to prevent transmission of toxoplasma to the fetus is spiramycin, but if it has occurred, then start the normal treatment of toxoplasma in mother and newborn. Okay. Now let's talk about other infection. You will write baby coccidiosis. It causes one infection just like malaria infection. Now what is the treatment of baby coccidiosis? In mild cases of baby coccidiosis, the drug of choice is a combination of two drugs, atovaquone, which is an anti-malarial drug, with azithromycin. While in severe cases, the drug of choice is one anti-malarial, quinine, with any other anti-malarial, clindamycin. Okay, baby coccidiosis. Next you will write is Balanitidium coli. Balanitidium coli also causes sexually transmitted infection, and just infection like entamoeba, it may cause amoebiasis, and it may cause sexually transmitted disease, like especially in diabetic patient. So Balanitidium coli, what is the treatment? The drug of choice for Balanitidium coli is tetracyclines. Okay, next you will write Cyclospora and Isospora. Cyclospora and Isospora, they cause diarrhea in HIV patients. Now what is the treatment? The drug of choice is cotrimoxazole. The drug of choice is cotrimoxazole. Sixth, you will write microsporidiosis or microspora. Microspora, microsporidiosis or microsporidia. It also causes diarrhea in HIV patient. If there is diarrhea in HIV patient due to microsporidia, the drug of choice is an anti-helminthic drug, albendazole. The drug of choice is albendazole. Remember, you can also give metronidazole. You can also give thalidomide to control this diarrhea. But remember, the drug of choice is metronidazole. This microsporidia sometimes causes a very dangerous infection known as keratoconjunctivitis or corneal ulcer in HIV patient. If there is keratoconjunctivitis due to microsporidia, the drug of choice is topical eye drops of fumagillin. Topical eye drops of fumagillin is a treatment of choice for keratoconjunctivitis due to microsporidia. And the last, protozoa, which is not a protozoa, which is half, sorry. The next one you will write is Naegleria fowleri. Naegleria, it causes one specific infection known as primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. It causes one infection, primary amoebic meningoencephalitis, a very dangerous infection with very high mortality rate. The drug of choice is amphotericin B. And the last, protozoa, which is half protozoa and half fungi, that is pneumocystis, Jerovecai infection. Now pneumocystis, Jerovecai infection, it causes pneumonias in HIV patient when the CD4 count falls less than 200 per millimeter cube. Okay, it causes pneumonia in HIV patient. Now what is the treatment? The drug of choice for both treatment and prophylaxis of pneumocystis. Prophylaxis you will start when the patient CD4 count is less than 200, but still the patient is not having pneumocystis infection. You will start the prophylaxis of cotrimoxazole. So the drug of choice for pneumocystis infection, both for treatment and prophylaxis, is cotrimoxazole. It's a very important point. Now, the further point is for treatment. You will write, in severe pneumonia, okay, in severe pneumonia, remember you have to add corticosteroids. You have to add corticosteroid, first point. You can also give aerosols or intravenous pentamidine. Okay, but remember the cotrimoxazole is the drug of choice, so pentamidine can also be used. Remember, in resistant cases, you can add dapsone with cotrimoxazole. Add dapsone to cotrimoxazole. Okay, you can give other drugs like a combination of primaquine with clindamycin, okay, anti-malarials. You can give this drug also. Now what are the other drugs which are effective but right now they are not approved? Other effective drugs you will write are atovaquone, again an anti-malarial, and lastly you will write trimetrixate. It's also a folic acid inhibitor, just like methotrexate. Okay, so these are the treatment of pneumocystis infection. So this is the complete list of the drugs for pneumocystis. The drug of choice is cotrimoxazole. In severe pneumonia, you have to add corticosteroid and pentamidine. In resistant cases, you must start with dapsone to cotrimoxazole, or start a combination of primaquine with clindamycin. Okay, so this is the treatment of all protozoan infection. So I hope you like this lecture. Thank you very much.